I sip the Dom P, watching Gandhi till I'm charged. Writing in my book of rhymes, all the words past the margin. The whole of mic a throbbing, mechanical movement. Understandable, smooth shit that murderers move with. The thief's theme, play me at night, they won't act right. A fiend of hip hop has got me stuck like a crack pipe. The mind activation, react like I'm faced to time like Pappy Mason. With pins I'm embracing, wipe the sweat off my dome, spit the phlegm on the street. In the Nikes on my feet, keep my cipher complete. Weather cruising in the six cab, a Montero Jeep. I can't call it. Beats make me falling asleep. I keep falling. Never falling 6 feet deep. I'm out for presidents to represent me. I'm out for presidents to represent me. I'm out for dead fucking presidents to represent me. The world is yours. Disciple of the project slash verbal murderer. Yeah, the world is yours. Till the Philly bloodheads, crack pumping drug murderers. The world is yours. Till my niggas coming home from lockdown with new plans. Fuck it, the world is mine. Holding a stolen cop's Glock with G notes in my hand. To my man Ill Will, God bless your life. To my peoples throughout Queens, God bless your life. My insight and light's vision, words of wisdom. Niggas pay me intuition to listen. The murder paragraphs of mysticism. Man plant seeds that brings forth multiple breeds. So many cultures on one planet, but one culture's free. Son, I need weed to proceed. Change the flow speed, I'm getting vexed. Giuliani is 666. There's no days for broke days, selling smoke pays. I took the chocolate, potent fillies, never roach sprayed. Shit is a hassle, the bridge is like a haunted castle. The mic's my religion, the system is the devil's lasso. And yo, the trife life is most influential. No colors on men's skins and pens is coincidental. How you living, larger broker? You waste your time extorting papers from smokers. Catching court papers, getting broke up. The world is mine, persona of late Tony Montana, yet getting mine. The whole world is mine. Who won it? I never fronted, I'm forever blunted. Getting live, handy up with the lie. Never stop, we don't stop the handy low. Puff the lie, y'all. Don't stop the handy low. We puff the lie. Every day, puff the lie. Plus the handy low. I'm the young city bandit. Hold myself down single handed. For murder raps, I kick my thoughts alone. Get remanded, born alone, die alone. No crew to keep my crown or throne. I'm deep, I sound alone. Cave inside a 1,000 miles from home. I need a new nigga. For this black cloud to follow. Cause while it's over me, it's too dark to see tomorrow. Trying to maintain, flip, fill the clip to the tip, picturing my peeps, 98 can make my heartbeat skip, and I'm amped up, they knock the champ up, even my brain's in handcuffs, headed for Indiana, stabbing bitches like the Phantom, the crew is mapping Ill Will style, check the go-to smell, plus I profile well, stash loot and fly clothes, burning dollars to light my soul, walk the blocks with a bop, check the games plus the games people play, I check the games plus the games people play, bust the problems of the world today. Yeah, wizard, keep that lie in the air. Yo, I wanna give a shout out to the whole fucking Queens. My man Tipster on the boards, keeping it real, Lord. The Queensbridge Nation, get it on. Faking no fucking jacks. Fuck around and get your wig pushed back. Big shout out to my man Killer. Braun, do it's on you. LES on another murder quest. 94, we out. Keep the lie in the air. MSC everywhere. Keep the lie going.
All right, man, let's get started. This is episode 500. Space and Technology. Please hit the like button as you come in, share the video if possible, hit that notification bell so you get all the updates from the Black Brain Trust, including those posts on the community tab, document description beneath the video for you to follow along with. If you want to engage in a discussion, there will be a link in the chat for you to click on. When you click on the link, make sure you raise your hand so that one of us can acknowledge you and advance you to the panel. We'll get started right away on the first item. We hit 500 episodes. 500 episodes. So here we go. First item on the docket is from livemint.com. Flat or negative growth in Indian IT sector this year, says former Infosys CFO. India's information technology sector is expected to post either flat or negative growth in 2020 due to the impact of the coronavirus pandemic globally, an IT industry veteran said on Saturday. Look at the economic activity globally, worse than what you've seen in the 2008 crisis. So clients, Indian IT companies, are not going to increase spending on IT or even maintain the current spending, the former chief financial officer of IT major Infosys. There will be a cut in spending and could be pressure on pricing because of all the major industries, including retail and financial services, have been adversely impacted, he said, also noting surging unemployment rate in the U.S. Economies are doing badly. Spending is not going to happen. I think this year is going to be the tough year of tough for the IT industry. The coronavirus pandemic is like a force majeure, and no amount of business continuity planning will help in this situation, he claimed. The Indian IT companies have to work closely with their clients, figure out how much they can extract at the same time they have to keep the costs under control and manage the current year, because in current year, if they have a positive growth, that will be a surprise. It will be either flat or negative growth this year because everything is happening in the first two quarters. When growth is always good, this year is going to be very tough. They have to plan their costs in such a way that margins they can hold on to so that they can reduce the impact. He said, even in 2008, after the global financial crisis, Indian IT companies had some growth because at the time, recovery happened very fast. Yeah, this is something that was unplanned. Okay, you kind of knew the market was going to go into a downturn in 2008 because you can see the numbers. If you were paying attention to the charts at the time, you can see where the market was trending and what the trajectory was going to be. But when it came to Corona recession, that was a different sort of change of plans, right? So you couldn't predict that this pandemic was going to take place within 1 to 2 weeks. Impossible. No way to tell and prepare for something like that. I don't care what kind of BCP, business continuity planning, or business impact analysis that you can do. There was no way you can actually prepare for something like this. And there's no real way to determine when this is gonna end. Some states and some countries might say May 4th or May 10th or something like that. This can go all the way to June. This can go all the way to July, September. I've heard some people say that their places are closing down until, third quarter. That's a long time. That's a very long time. So all budgets are on hold. No one can interact with each other. No one can actually walk into a data center. No one can deploy these laptops, and no one can deploy software. You can't meet with each other in the same traditional way. So a lot of things are on hold because no one knows where everything's going to go. So IT industry is definitely going to have some setbacks in some areas. Let me give a shout out to people in the chat before I go forward. Floyd Holt. Welcome to the live stream. Mugen Black, what's going on? What else is going on? Let me move on to the next item on the docket. All right, this is from fastcompany.com. How big tech survives recessions and always comes out stronger. As an analyst, I've been involved with the tech industry for 40 years now and have lived through at least 5 recessions during that time. I've noticed that many of the tech companies that survive them share some things in common. The Great Recession caused by the housing bubble in 2007-2008 was devastating for some industries. Some, like the auto industry, needed bailout money to survive. Tech stocks took some hard hits, but the industry survived and eventually recovered. It was during the same period that I learned a valuable lesson about the resilience of tech companies in periods of economic downturn. I was working with Intel CEO at the time, the late Paul Ottolini, and his marketing team. The mood inside Intel was a bit dour, as it was inside most companies. During a meeting a few months into the recession, a few of us asked Ottolini how the recession might impact the chip company he had. His answer was brilliant. He said that recessions come and go, and some are worse than others. While some companies might hunker down and slow down their research and development, Intel had no intention of doing that. Intel, he said, would increase its R&D budget in preparation for time in the near future when demand for the company's products would rise again. When that time came, he said he wanted Intel to be ready with innovative products to meet the needs of its customers. Invest more during recessionary times seems to be a real mantra with many of the tech CEOs I have spoken to. They understand that they can't stand still. They must be ready when people's confidence and ability to buy new products rebound. Given the potential impact on world markets caused by COVID-19 and the recent oil price war, most economists believe that we could be headed for another worldwide recession. While that has not yet been confirmed, the threat is real. Tech is already at the forefront of helping us deal with various disruptions from the COVID-19 threat as people use video conferencing and online collaborative tools to work from home. Many of us stream music, video, and games to help us through our self-imposed quarantines. Colleges and schools are forced to deliver their classes online to keep their students safe and isolated. Our research firm has observed that demand for laptops with better quality cameras and audio is starting to pick up steam. As workers and students are forced to work and learn at home, older PCs with poor quality cameras and audio won't cut it if they have to interact with customers and teachers online. Smartphones are our communication lifelines to friends and families when we can't meet them in person. But this was true even before the coronavirus outbreak. Although the tech industry is not immune to a recession, it is a much better place to weather the crisis than the travel industry. For example, in some ways, tech is being used to substitute for travel that's no longer possible during the public health emergency. We'll see the need for more technology, not less, to help us get through this challenging time in our history. Given that many tech companies increase their R&D in downtimes, the big question is, what new technology current investments will eventually yield? The one consistent answer I get from tech leaders is that it will be transformational technology related to 5G. Many see 5G as the heart of the next decade's tech boom, along with the virtual reality, augmented reality, and mixed reality. So VR, AR, MR, these are things that Hard Fork Rich in the chat, who frequents our chat, he talks about this a lot now because he's getting involved in this. He's starting at the very early onset, so it's good for him. While 5G availability is 5G availability in the US is still limited, most believe that we will see strong 5G networks in place by late 2021 or early 2022. So you're talking next year. With that in mind, almost all companies in tech are doing extensive research on how 5G might enable new and innovative products in the future. All smartphone makers are prepping new 5G phones and expect to see a very high demand for those devices later this year, and especially into 2021. 5G will be critical for autonomous vehicles, smart buildings, and smart cities, and the Internet of Things. It'll enable companies like Quibi, which will soon offer short form videos to deliver new types of content. Big tech companies are already investing millions in AR, VR, and mixed reality technologies that could reinvent the human-machine interface. Apple is expected to bring its AR mixed reality glasses to market sometime in late 2022 or early 2023. Some tech leaders believe Apple could be the company that makes spatial computing a mass market technology. Apple is increasing its R&D budgets in this area. It can't afford not to, given the technology's potential, even if a recession is in place. Facebook is working hard on creating virtual meeting rooms in VR environments. If done right, this could represent the next big wave in video conferencing. So again, we see that AR, VR, MR is being up for discussion as a form of tech to pay attention to. Not all tech companies come out strong after recession. Some may not even survive, but history shows us that recessions can also serve a purpose. The dot-com burst of 1999 and 2000, for example, was a tough one for tech. But in the end, it weeded out the companies that got funded on business models that didn't show a clear path to actually making money. From 2002 to 2008, we saw companies grow more disciplined and only got funded if they showed real promise as money makers. During this period, Facebook, Twitter, Uber, and many others took off and started the tech boom that continues even today. As they watch their businesses and the economy threatened by the coronavirus, tech companies need to consider Paul Otellini's advice. Invest more in R&D even during a recession, knowing that the market will eventually rebound and new innovative technologies will drive to future demand. Yeah, I don't have anything against what he's saying. I think that this is actually a good time to actually study more, right? If you are, we covered this on Saturday, some of the best tech certifications to study for while you're in a downtime for 4 weeks. You never stop studying. You never stop innovating. That's just a part of the tech industry. You can't stop because something is happening. You have to keep moving forward. Okay, so I don't see any companies letting up, as far as I know. I think they're all pretty much moving forward on everything. Let me go to the next item on the docket. All right. Next item on the docket is from semiengineering.com. The IoT of COVID-19. Let me expand this. Data from the Internet of Things, IoT, and mobile devices are providing a surprising view on the COVID-19 pandemic. Like an invisible hurricane churning over us, the pandemic's effects are huge, but the tiny virus that causes it is very difficult to see directly. Data can save lives. Early detection, isolating those who are positive, contact tracing, and isolating those who had contact are key to controlling the spread. That implies data because of asymptomatic spread. Again, we are blind without testing everyone. Some countries got it right in the beginning by initiating strict controls, quick testing, and contact tracing. They found a way to find the data they needed to early to flatten the curve. Other countries, well, we are doing things a harder way. At least here in the US and around the world, we have plenty of smart people working the problems and a lot of Admiral MacGyverism dealing with low medical supplies. Putting our privacy concerns aside now, IoT and other data collection is looking promising. Taking temperatures, for instance, temperature taking is important as a first sign of sickness. Looking at temperature and heart rate data may be one way to see virus clusters, such as IoT thermometers that can send temperature data back to a central location that can map hotspots. Kinsa has been sharing some of his data from IoT thermometers. Some universities in California are also studying if monitoring temperature and heart rates of healthcare workers using Aura smart rings and other wearables can help predict if and when a worker gets sick. AI is a key ingredient in IoT and other efforts to speed up finding speed up finding at-risk people and help with testing and triage. AI used to read chest x-rays, triage patients, track supplies, and beds, says stat article. Eventually, quantum computers may be used in the fight to identify drugs that might help. The location trackers in smartphones help us see who is moving around really when we are supposed to be sheltering in place. Even sewers can give another clue. Several groups have been detecting viruses in the sewer system, tells us it's here. Wow. That's interesting. We are in the middle of it now. The observations we make today may or may not help make things better during the pandemic, but they will be important for improve public health in general and help us be ready for the next one. Perhaps in the countries where we are concerned about abuse of private information, these IoT investigations can give us an understanding of when we are willing to have our private information used for public good. We have no shortage of ideas. Now, the problem, as IEEE Spectrum points out, is a shortage of engineers. Also, supply lines are a problem, but maybe AI can help us think that one through too someday. Right now, we're just putting up a good fight. Bravo to all the people who are trying to make this better. So we have somebody in the chat who's an engineer, engineering cannabis. He just said 5G adoption of IoT. This article points to 5G adoption as well as big data. So data science, 5G, IoT, artificial intelligence, machine learning, reinforced learning, deep learning, cloud computing, quantum computing, okay? Blockchain, distributed ledger technology. All of these things are happening right now. They need this right now. There's not enough engineers. That's what the article just said. We need more engineers. This is the time for Black people, especially Black men, to really step up their game between now and 2022. Okay? This is very critical. There's not enough medical professionals, healthcare professionals to actually even have a literacy of something like this. Gonna go into healthcare? You better back it up with IT. You better back it up with some form of computer science. This is where the market is going. So while people want to say, yeah, you can just get by and you can wait it out. Can't wait this out anymore. The article just said it. This is from semi-engineering, right? Semiconductor engineering, deep insights for tech industry. This is a reputable source. We've been talking about this for the last couple of years. You gotta get into engineering, some form of STEM. You gotta get into STEM. STEM. That's what this has to be about. Okay. Let me go on to the next item on the docket. All right. This is from fastcompany.com. Want to cut toilet paper out of your life? We've tested this bidet and love it. Interesting. I'm not going to read this whole thing. As we all know, some Americans have gotten quite excitable when it comes to buying and hoarding toilet paper in these trying times. And while I hope most of us out there aren't actually that panicked, I see this moment of ultra plush double roll weakness as a crucial time to make a case for the most underutilized bathroom fixture in the US, the bidet. You see, I made it through a good portion of my life without ever using a bidet. My cousins, the rich ones, had one in their gated community mansion, but I never really knew what it was and spent many a childhood moment giggling when one of them said it was for washing your butt. Even after spending most of my early 20s traveling to many countries where bidets are commonplace, I still avoided all use of the nether region washing machines. Nether region washing machines. It wasn't until I was 25 in South Korea and drank a little too much soju that I finally sat down and turned on the spigot. This is coming from a woman. Keep that in mind. And as many other late bidet bloomers accounts go, my life was changed. I finally felt clean without chafing, irritation, or paper bits stuck to my bits. For the first time, I spent a bus ride between Busan and Gangneung the next day Googling all the rational, hygienic reasons to use a bidet and trying to figure out why Americans thought they were gross when in fact smearing dry paper across your bum is, well, yeah. I decided right then and there that when I finally got a place of my own, I would do my part to end the stigma of a bathroom's best kept secret and install a bidet in my bathroom. And not just any bidet, but one of the futuristic temperature regulating, perfectly pressurized multi-stage washers that I had experienced in South Korea. I wanted a smart bidet to install onto a toilet. It's my conviction that bidet seats are preferable to traditional bidet fixtures for two reasons. One, they save space in a room where space is often not easy to come by. And two, they allow you to remain on the toilet instead of haphazardizing jumping between two lavatory appliances, which just seems more hygienic. That's interesting. So basically, what's going on? Sorry. Basically, what's going on here is that they have an IoT bathroom seat. Imagine it, right? You have this sort of Nintendo Wii controller style system to clean your pussy if you're a woman. Very interesting. Fast forward a few years later, it's late 2019, and my partner and I are closing on our first home. It's monumentous for me, not exclusively because I get to finally have a bidet, but that certainly was a factor. Although we inherited a bathroom shaped like a hallway and painted Kermit the Frog green by the previous owners, I was thrilled to modernize it a bit with not only a splash of white paint, but also with the installation of the perfect smart bidet seat, the Colway Bidet Mega 200. Interesting. The Bidet Mega 200 is as feature packed as its risable name suggests. It boasts a heated seat, three different temperature settings for the water, a multi-stage wash, customized pressure and water direction, and a built-in dryer. Setup was easy as a woman who has never followed a recipe in her life, hoped it would be. After acquiring either elongated or the round design, you unscrew your current toilet seat, screw this one on, and install a T connector to your toilet's water supply, plug it into an outlet, and congratulate yourself on a job well done. So, I've never used one of these because we're in the States and we don't really get these. I find this to be very interesting that, and I don't know why in the States we don't use them. I guess it's for a variety of reasons as to why we don't adopt European technologies or innovations, even driving on the right-hand side of the road like the British do. So there's a lot of things that we just don't do that would make sense if we actually did adopt it. I don't know. I guess Americans just have a different perspective on life, even things such as the metric, table and stuff like that, how you measure things. You know, everybody else uses one standard and we use a completely different standard. So this is something that I had never thought of before for myself as a guy. I don't really look at things that way, but I guess there's a time and a place for it, right? All right, let me jump to the next item on the docket. All right, this is from techcrunch.com. Visa's Africa strategy banks on startups partnerships. Visa has prioritized growth in Africa, and partnering with startups is central to its strategy. This became obvious in 2019 after the global financial services giant entered a series of collaborations on the continent. But Visa confirmed it in their 2020 Investor Day presentation. On the company's annual call, participants mentioned Africa 28 times and featured African startup prominently in the accompanying deck. Visa's president for Central and Eastern Europe, Middle East and Africa, SEMA, Andrew Torre, detailed the region's payment potential and his company's plans to tap it. We're partnering with non-conventional players to realize the potential. Fintechs, neobanks, that's something new, and digital wallets to reach the 1 billion consumer opportunity, he said. So they're talking about Africa being a future, if not current, player in terms of market potential. TechCrunch has covered a number of Visa's Africa collaborations and spoke to two execs driving the company's engagement with startups from Nigeria to South Africa. And interesting, we were just talking about Nigeria and South Africa yesterday. Visa's head of strategic partnerships, FinTech and Ventures for Africa, Otto Williams, has been out front traveling the continent and engaging FinTech founders. Located in Cape Town, Visa's group general manager for Sub-Saharan Africa, Ada Diara, oversees the company's operations in 48 countries. The company has a long track record working with the region's large bank entities, but that shifted to smaller ventures. So this is behind the paywall, the rest of it is behind the paywall. But point of the matter here is that Visa is seeing rapid growth on the continent, okay? Rapid growth on the continent when it comes to startups. As the article mentioned, it says Visa has mentioned it 28 times in one of its annual calls. So they're seeing a lot of opportunity on the continent to actually bank people, okay? Move on to the next article. All right, this is from Forbes.com. Why this period is a rare opportunity for new and existing startups. To build a successful startup, you must create a product people need. This is entrepreneurship 101 and a valid rule, no matter the markets, industry, or business model. What we can learn from today's turbulent times is that in many cases, even needed products can turn into good-to-have solutions. In fact, due to circumstances like inaccessibility, must-have solutions can also suffer. If you're launching a startup at this time of the year, the market should have made a major job a bit easier. It doesn't take years of startup experience to predict if customers will use your product. Tough economic conditions will not last. As such, you can either use this period to improve your product or revisit your value proposition to address and capture today's urgent needs. And if you have an existing product, you can do one of two things. Nothing. Waiting is certainly one of your options. Laying off team members or completely shutting down operations can reduce or eliminate operating expenses, which will minimize losses in the short run. However, because long-term performance depends on your short-term plans, the question is, how will this affect the future when everything is back to normal? Real leadership manifests in tough times. Surrendering to economic conditions means that the market controls your performance. While this is true in many ways, a true leader will adapt. Whether it is tapping into new markets, offering new solutions, or restructuring pricing strategy, A true leader will find a way to keep the business afloat even and even grow. Furthermore, turbulent economic periods are rare opportunities to take on projects with long-term returns. Instead of pausing operation, many of your team members can shift focus to build new foundations with big future layoffs. Number two, strive to keep your customers. Our company helps entrepreneurs launch startups. Many of our clients with businesses have been affected by today's economic conditions. For many, launching a startup is no longer a top priority. Last week, I called a few of our key clients whom I know experienced a significant decline in business performance. I proposed to them with anything they need for their existing businesses, whether it is marketing, sales, operation strategy, consulting, and even customer service. One of our clients recently told me that if it weren't for our initiative, he would have suggested to pause our partnership. Think about what your customers really need today. While focus is critical for startup success, flexibility and adaptability are even more important. If your product is no longer a priority for your customers, either address their needs or build solutions that do. Customers' budget does not suddenly disappear during economic dips. If you offer good-to-have solutions, your job is to justify the company's value in comparison to customers' top priorities. Follow these simple steps. Number one, if you run a growing startup, list your most valuable customers. Number two, research and list what you believe are their top priorities and what you can help with. Number three, email or call to offer support. Offer your support in your listed areas plus anything. I don't know what just happened. Anything else they urgently need. It is cheaper to keep a customer than acquire a new one. This is the best time to strengthen your relationship with your customers. Your commitment to helping them with their priorities will not be forgotten. Remember that business is all about human relationships. In sum, it's important to recognize the opportunity that turbulent times bring to your startup. If you're launching a new venture, use your market insights as a validation tool and a guide to help build a product people need. If you run a startup, this is the best time to strengthen your relationship with your employees and customers while investing in projects with long-term returns. Yeah, this is all good information. I see nothing wrong with the information that's being provided here. I think that when Black people look at startups, you know, they think about Facebook and several other big daddy ventures. And, you know, you can adopt some of the principles from these articles and actually use it to launch a startup. So, all right, let me go to the next item on the docket. All right, next item on the docket from Psychology Today. Intelligence is a whole brain phenomenon. Explain this out. General cognitive ability and white matter connectivity may go hand in hand. I'm not gonna read this whole thing, I'm just gonna read a few paragraphs because I think this is good enough to actually have a whole entire live stream on by itself. Intelligence involves gray matter and white matter connectivity throughout the entire brain. According to a new meta-analysis, the findings of this international collaboration, which involved over three dozen scientists from around the globe, were published on March 26th in the American Journal of Psychiatry. This meta-analysis project was led by Lorena Halloran of the NUI Galloway in Ireland. Holloman is a professor of the School of Psychology and Center for Neuroimaging Cognition and Genomics, as well as a lecturer in clinical neuroscience. In total, the International Collaborative analyzed brain scans and cognitive functions measurements from 1,717 participants. Some study participants were patients with schizophrenia. Others were part of a control group of healthy participants. Schizophrenia has recently been associated with widespread white matter microstructure, structural abnormalities. But the functional effect of these abnormalities remain unclear. The author's right. A relatively new state-of-the-art brain imaging technique called diffusion tensor imaging, DTI, provides fresh insights into the relationship between the white matter microstructures that connect different brain regions and general cognitive ability. Previous literature suggested that general intelligence relies on a specific gray matter area of the brain, including temporal, parietal, and frontal regions. However, the results from the study indicate that efficient connection pathways across the entire brain provide a neural network that supports general cognitive function. Interesting. You know what? I'm gonna redo this on Saturday for Black Healthcare Talk. I think that's very important. This is a very important article. If you're talking about artificial intelligence and human intelligence and stuff like that, that's definitely a very critical article. All right, let me jump to the next item on the docket. All right, next item on the docket is from nature.com. Artificial intelligence decodes the facial expressions of mice. Neuroscientists also uncover neural circuitry whose activity correlates with particular emotions. This is going to be interesting. Expand this out. Researchers have used a machine learning algorithm to decipher the seemingly instructurable facial expressions of laboratory mice. The work could have implications for pinpointing neurons in the human brain that encode particular expressions. Their study is an important first step in understanding some of the mysterious aspects of emotions and how they manifest in the brain, says neuroscientist David Anderson at the California Institute of Technology in Pasadena. Nearly 150 years ago, Charles Darwin proposed that facial expressions in animals might provide a window onto their emotions, as they do in humans, but researchers have only recently gained the tools, such as powerful microscopes, cameras, and genetic techniques, to reliably capture and analyze facial movement and investigate how emotions arise in the brain. I was fascinated by the fact that we humans have emotional states which we experience as feelings, says neuroscientist Nadine Gogola at the Max Planck Institute of Neurobiology in Martin Street, Germany, who led the 3-year study. I wanted to see if we could learn about how these states emerge in the brain from animal studies. The work is published in Science. Mice have facial expressions that correspond to emotions, just like humans. So I don't know how they figured this out, because a mouse doesn't really have, I guess you would need a microscope to see it, but I don't know if just looking at the optics from the screen itself, you really can't tell if a mouse is happy or if a mouse is sad or anything like that. You can only tell by the squeaking on first observation. but they're using this, I guess a thermal camera that can tell all the warm areas and the cold areas of the face. Let me go down some more. Gogola took inspiration from a 2014 Cell paper that Anderson wrote with Ralph Edoffs, also at the California Institute of Technology. In the study, they theorized that brain states such as emotion should exhibit particular characteristics. They should be persistent, for example, enduring for some time after the stimulus that evoked them as disappeared. And they should scale with the strength of the stimulus. Gogola's team fixed the heads of the mice to keep them still, then provided different sensory stimuli intended to trigger particular emotions and fill the animals' faces. For example, the researchers placed either sweet or bitter fluids on their creatures' lips to invoke pleasure or disgust. They also gave mice small but painful electric shocks to the tail, or injected the animals with lithium chloride to induce malaise. This is interesting. The scientists knew that a mouse can change its expression by moving its ears, cheeks, nose, and the upper parts of its eyes. But they couldn't reliably assign the expressions to particular emotions. So they broke down the videos of facial muscle movements into ultra short snapshots as the animals responded to the different stimuli. Also, that's how they got it. Machine learning algorithms recognize distinct expressions created by the movement of particular groups of facial muscles. These expressions correlated with the evoked emotional states such as pleasure, disgust, or fear. For example, a mouse experiencing pleasure pulls its nose down towards its mouth and pulls its ears and jaw forwards. By contrast, when it is in pain, it pulls back its ears and bulks out its cheeks and sometimes squints. The facial expressions had the characteristics that Anderson and Edoffs had proposed. For example, they were persistent and their strength correlated with the intensity of the stimulus. This way of looking at facial expression is a big advantage because it avoids any biases of the experimenter, says Camilla Bellone at the University of Geneva in Switzerland, who studies neuropsychiatric disorders. They put a lot of emphasis behind this. I don't think people really understand this. Yeah, engineering cannabis says neural networking uses it for deep learning, now using it to actually study neural network in the brains. Yeah, you're right about that. Finally, the team used a technique called two-photon calcium imaging to identify individual neurons in the mouse brain that fired only when particular emotions and particular expressions were evoked. They may represent part of the coding for emotions in the brain, speculates Gogola. We think that encoding for emotion may be evolutionary conserved, and so the encoding in humans and mice may share some common features. Wow. But you would need to do this. You would need to repeat this whole entire task 1,000 different times in order to get enough sufficient data to present this to artificial intelligence so that artificial intelligence also reacts with the same sort of emotion. This is a big, big industry. This is really, really big. If you're trying to get into tech right now, this is where it is. This is exactly where it is. We got Nagon 11 on the panel. Jump to the next item on the docket.
What's up, Mike?
Hey, what's going on, dude?
All right, man. Great article. It's a great article.
Yeah, it is. All right, next item I want to talk is from bigthink.com. An AI can read words and brain signals. Okay. AI can read words and brain signals. It's just a start, but it's pretty exciting. A system that translates brain activity into text. For those unable to physically speak, such as people with locked-in syndrome, for example, this would be a life changer. Right now, it's a bit like seeing through a heavy fog, but researchers at the Chang Lab at the University of California at San Francisco have trained a machine learning algorithm to extract meaning from neuronal data. This is huge. Joseph Macon, a co-author of this research, tells The Guardian, "We are not there yet, but we think this could be the basis of speech prosthesis. To train their AI, Macon and co-author Edward F. Chang listen in on the neural activity of four participants. As epileptics, each participant had had brain electrodes implanted for the purpose of seizure monitoring. The participants were supplied 50 sentences they were to read aloud at least three times. As they did, neural data was collected by the researchers. Audio recordings were also made. The study lists a handful of the sentences participants recited among them. Those machines harmonized marvelously. She wore warm, fleecy, woolen overalls. Those thieves stole 30 jewels. There is also, there is chaos in the kitchen." Sounds like the management. "The algorithm's task was to analyze the collected neural data and make predictions as to what was being said when the data was generated. The researcher's algorithm learned pretty quickly to predict the words associated with the chunks of neural data. The AI predicted the data generated when a little bird is watching the commotion was spoken would mean the little bird is watching the commotion quite close. While the ladder was used to rescue the cat and the man was predicted as which ladder will be used to rescue the cat and the man." That machine learning is picking up really quickly. "The accuracy varied from participant to participant. Macon and Chang found that an algorithm based on the participant had a head start on being trained for another, suggesting that training the AI could get easier over time in repeated use." You see this? So pay attention to this last sentence. "The accuracy varied from participant to participant. Making and Chang found that an algorithm based on one participant had a head start on being trained for another, suggesting that training the AI could get easier over time in repeated use." So it doesn't take that long. You know, a lot of people think, well, you won't see this type of stuff for the next, 20 years, 30 years. No, this will take a few months. It'll be easier to train every single time. The task is repeated. Okay. It'll keep correcting itself because it has to. The Guardian spoke with the expert Christian Herf, who found this system impressive for using less than 40 minutes of training data for each participant rather than the far greater amount of time required by other attempts to derive text from neural data, he says. "By doing so, they achieve levels of accuracy that haven't been achieved so far. Previous attempts to derive speech from neural activity focused on the phonemes from which spoken words are built. But Macon and Chang focused on the overall words instead. While there are certainly more words than phonemes, and thus this poses a greater challenge," the study says. "The production of any particular phoneme in continuous speech is strongly influenced by the phonemes preceding it. which decreases its distinguishability. To minimize the difficulty of their word-based approach, the spoken sentences use a total of just 250 words. So you're talking about a pretty strong paragraph is what they used. Through the neural fog. Clearly, though there's room for improvement, the AI also predicted that those musicians harmonized marvelously was the spinach from a famous singer. She wore warm, fleecy woolen overalls, was mispredicted as the oasis was a mirage. Those thieves stole 30 jewels was misconstrued as which theater shows Mother Goose. While the algorithm predicted the data for there is chaos in the kitchen meant there is helping him steal a cookie. So what the artificial intelligence is doing is it's trying to match lyrics to, they're trying to match sentences to lyrics, and when it cannot find a lyric, it's also matching the sentence to other, Western sayings. That's actually really good, that it can do all of this in real time. It's processing it in real time. Of course, the vocabulary involved in this research is limited, as are the sentences exemplars. If you try to go outside of the 50 sentences used, the decoding gets much worse. Notes Macon, citing the limitations of his study. Another obvious caveat comes from the fact that the AI was trained from sentences spoken aloud by each participant and impossibility with a locked-in patience. Still, the research by Macon and Chang is encouraging. Predictions for one of their participants require just a tiny 3% correction. Okay? That's actually better than the 5% error rate found in human transcriptions. So they're talking about a 97% accuracy rate with their AI. That's actually really good. That's actually really good, man. Now's the time to get into AI. I don't know what else to say about this. This is an example. This article is an example of where AI and data science comes together. Engineering, cannabis in the chat can tell you a lot about data science. That's what he does for a living. And so AI, data science, machine learning, all of this stuff comes into play. This is a big market right now. Bare minimum salary for anyone trying to get into this market is around 110K, 120K a year. Okay. This is big time stuff. Oh. We want to the next article. Waymo's AI improves autonomous vehicle performance while saving costs. This is from VentureBeat.com. Waymo, Alphabet's self-driving vehicle research division, today detailed a system, Progressive Population-Based Augmentation, PPBA. It claims has improved the performance of its autonomous systems while reducing the amount of data required to train them. Specifically, Waymo says PPBA bolstered its car's object detection capability while decreasing costs and accelerating the training process. It's early days, but the approach could improve Waymo vehicle's robustness in challenging driving scenarios, while the fleet remains grounded by the COVID-19 pandemic. The The situation Waymo's cars encounter in the real world and in simulation give the company's engineers opportunities to train the models underlying the Waymo driver, Waymo's full-stack driverless platform. By way of background, the Waymo driver, which is now in its fifth generation, relies on a custom suite of LiDAR cameras and radars, as well as algorithms that enable it to interpret and respond to the sensor data. Typically, ensuring these models are highly generalizable require a large, diverse set of training data and recruiting a human team to manually annotate the data. But the PPBA automates the bulk of the process by discovering ways to synthesize additional data. PPBA takes cues from AutoAugment, a Google Research and Google Brain project that uses various image augmentation operations, such as rotation, cropping, image mirroring, and color shifting to morph and transform data. Trained through reinforcement learning, it selects the best augmentation policy for a given sample set while reducing the computational cost of searching for policies. PPBA also builds on Waymo's existing data augmentation efforts. In early 2019, the company began applying techniques from Google Brain and Google Research algorithm called RANAugment to image based classification and detection tasks. Waymo reports that it's achieved significant improvements in several classifiers and detectors as a result, including those that help classify foreign objects such as construction equipment and animals. PPBA targets LiDAR, which measures the distance to target objects by illuminating them with a laser light and measuring the reflected pulses. Beyond 3D spatial information, logs from LiDAR sensors contain parameters such as distance, operation, strength, and sampling probability. To discover policies designed for point cloud datasets, PPBA works on a point augmentation search space containing 8 operations, each of which is associated with a probability and specific parameters. The original data sample, a ground truth augmentation, a random flip, word scaling, a global translate noise. This is, and it goes on, but it's actually pretty good. This is actually a little longer than what we intended to, but AI is here. This is big stuff. This is really big stuff. But let me share my screen so that, let me see. My screen real quick. This is for Udacity. Udacity does have a program for artificial intelligence. Here it is right here. Okay, if you haven't seen this before, and it's actually it's 50% off, so you're only going to pay $1,000 or less than $1,000 for the nano degree program. Okay, AI is one of the fastest growing and most transformational technologies of our time, with 2.3 million new jobs opening up by 2020. Spend 10 hours per week to advance your career. This is big stuff, okay? AI for business leaders. Intro to machine learning with TensorFlow. AI product manager. Intro to machine learning with PyTorch. Machine learning engineer. AI programming with Python. Deep learning. Artificial intelligence for trading. Computer vision. Natural language processing. Deep reinforcement learning, artificial intelligence. Yeah. So I would definitely recommend people who are trying to make a career transition now, now's the time to start looking at this stuff. I'll drop that in the chat. Jay Green asked a question, how do Waymo vehicles fare in bad weather? If you're talking about snowing, I don't know if that's ever been done before. They haven't reported anything about that, but they seem to do well in inclement weather because they have the lasers on them. All right. Let me go on to the next article. All right, let's go to here. All right, we'll move on to the next article. This is not working. All right, this is from space.com. Private companies find role in developing nuclear power for space travel. Let's spread this out. Space is about to go nuclear, at least if private companies get their way. At the 23rd Annual Commercial Space Transportation Conference in Washington, D.C., in January, a panel of nuclear technology experts and leaders in the commercial space industry spoke about development of the technology that could propel future spacecraft faster and more efficiently than current systems can. Nuclear technology has powered spacecraft such as NASA's Mars rover, the Cassini mission, and the two Voyagers that are currently exploring the outer reaches of our solar system. But those fuel sources rely on the passive decay of radioactive plutonium, converting heat from the process into electricity to power the spacecraft. Instead, the CST panelists discussed nuclear thermal propulsion, a technology developed in the 1960s and 70s that relies on the splitting or fission of hydrogen atoms. Although the fission is associated with more warlike images, the panel's experts emphasized the safety of nuclear thermal propulsion, which would use low-enriched uranium. An NTP-powered spacecraft would pump hydrogen propellant through a miniature nuclear reactor core. Inside this reactor core, high-energy neutrons would split uranium atoms in fission reactions. Those free neutrons would smack into other atoms and trigger more fission. The heat from these reactions would convert the hydrogen propellant into gas, which would produce thrust when forced through a nozzle. This chain reaction is key to NTP's power. Panelist Vanessa Clark, CEO of Atomos Space, a company that's developing thermonuclear propulsion-powered spacecraft to provide in-space transportation options to satellite operators, told space.com, a soda can-sized fission reactor could propel humans to Mars in just 3 to 4 months, she said. About twice as fast as the currently estimated time it could take a chemically propelled ship to carry humans to the red planet. Soda can size. So you're talking about 12 ounces at best. The reason we want to use a reactor is we have a lot of power from it, which is really what enables us to be so agile and move such heavy payloads so quickly. So where does the commercial sector fit in? According to Jeff Thornburg, CEO of Interstellar Technologies, an aerospace engineering company focused on propulsion, and another panelist, in the speed that commercial ventures offer, which can get new technologies off the ground, both literally and figuratively. I know how fast we've changed the dynamic and how we develop technology for the space, for the commercial space sector for launch now, which didn't exist 20 years ago. Thornburg told space.com he wants to apply that same methodology to developing fast and efficient nuclear propulsion. I don't think the government's going to be able to move quickly enough to stay competitive in this technology area, Thornburg said. He noted that NASA is currently focused on Artemis lunar program, and launching to the moon doesn't necessarily require nuclear technology. This is true. Sending astronauts to Mars and minimizing their time in a dangerous radiation environment, however, may require a faster propulsion system. And that's what NTP technology might provide. But the government still has to play some role. Both Clark and Thornburg said, government agencies like NASA and the military branches may be the first clients for these commercial companies. Clark noted NASA's recent pushes to partner with private sector such as Commercial Lunar Payload Services Program and its Commercial Crew Program. Government players, NASA, and also now in the Air Force, are looking at procuring services rather than funding the development of technology, which is really, really exciting for us. Yeah, this is, we've been saying this for about a year and a half now. We've been saying this for a year and a half now that space exploration is the next startup. One in every four startups will be a space startup or have something remotely to do with space. We see this happening right now. SpaceX, Tesla, Waymo, Too Simple. Out of those four or five startups I just mentioned, one of them is actually a space startup, and that's SpaceX. So keep that in mind. All right. Let me go to the last item on the docket and do a close out. All right, this is from the scientificamerican.com. COVID-19 shutdown may obscure mysteries of cracked interstellar comet. Pristine alien material from the Object 21, or 2L, Borisov, is being exposed to space for the first time, but the coronavirus pandemic is stopping astronomers from watching. About 4 months ago, in December 2019, the interstellar comet known as 2I Borisov made it to Gennady Borisov in August 2019. Astronomers raced to observe the object, only the second known visitor from another star since the asteroid like Oumuamua in 2017 before it drifted out of our view. But aside from mainly watching Borisov, they were hoping for something else, that the warmth of the sun would crack the comet apart, releasing material from its innards that was scarcely, if at all, altered from forming billions of years ago in an alien star system. In late March, those hopes were fulfilled. Observations from two teams of astronomers using the Hubble telescope have confirmed that a large chunk of debris up to 100 meters in size has broken off from the comet's solid icy core, known as nucleus, which is itself up to 500 meters across. This fragment was moving away from the comet at about 0.5 meter per second, and was seen more than 180 kilometers from its nucleus. A small fragment of the primary nucleus has come off, says David Jewett of the University of California, Los Angeles, who leads one of the teams. Something came out. Later images from Hubble revealed the fragment has since disintegrated, but the comet could well continue to cast off debris. Borisov, often referred to as the comet Borisov, was discovered. Astronomers have been eagerly studying its reflected light using a process called spectroscopy to discover its composition and compare it to more familiar homegrown objects in our solar system. They have detected traces of water, cyanide, oxygen, and more. How do they do that in such a short amount of time? Those findings could be but a prelude to the treasure trove of data from observations of Borisov as it breaks apart. Cracking it open is even more exciting, because what we're really interested in is what this thing is made of, says Dennis Bodwitz of Auburn University, who is part of the other Hubble team. If you crack it open, you get material that's never been heated before. The building blocks of another solar system. Interesting. Borisov made his closest approach to the sun on December 8th, 2019. Reaching about twice the Earth-Sun distance. While the origin of the object is not known, this event may have been the first time it has ever been significantly heated by a star, a process that causes ices to boil off its comets as gases lending from their distinctive tail. It was not until early March, however, that Borisov showed any signs of responding to the heating when it let out multiple outbursts of material. These outbursts may have increased the comet's rotational speed, resulting in the subsequent fragmentation that has now been observed. If the nucleus spin itself, because of these outgassing torques, it can spin so fast that it has that it basically flies apart, George says. We can calculate the gravitational escape speed for this nucleus, and we can guess the density to be like other comets. The test that will come in the future, if we ever get to see the nucleus without dust around it. As to why it took the comet until now to fragment, Michelle Bannister of the University of Canterbury in New Zealand, says she was a little surprised, considering the closest approach to the sun was 4 months ago. She notes, however, that Borisov's high speed as compared with the sun may have played a part, swooping the object past our star much faster than native comets and thus subjecting it to less overall heating. You do have to shift your expectations a bit relative to the solar system stuff, Bannister says. Hubble alone will be able to tell us a great deal about this event and any subsequent activity from Borisov. Yet astronomers have lamented the unfortunate timing of this never before seen breakup happening now, when most of the world's major observatories are shuttered because of the coronavirus pandemic. The comet is now only visible in the Southern Hemisphere, and all major facilities in the Southern Hemisphere, from Chile to Australia to South Africa, are closed. Bannister notes she and her colleagues could normally be measuring the composition of the interior in earnest with instruments such as the Very Large Telescope in Chile. Observations that for now are simply not possible. Hubble is a beautiful thing, but it has a bunch of different tools that are specialized to very particular purposes, she says. I'm not sure that Borisov going to be bright enough to in some of the parts of the spectrum. We have the available instrumentation on Hubble. What we can measure about the composition will be substantially limited. Although Borisov will remain visible to Hubble for up to another year, ground telescopes will only have a couple of months before it becomes too faint to study. Whether the pandemic's grip on the globe will have loosened by by then is unclear. But for the time being, the grand finale of one of our solar system's most extraordinary events is airing without a full house. Yeah. Stupid pandemic has all the facilities closed, all of them, except one. You know, the Hubble is still open. Now, who manages it? But we have talked about this before, that you can now build a nano satellite. And we talked about using DSLR cameras on a nano satellite to actually replace or serve as an alternative to something like a Hubble telescope. A Hubble telescope is massive. It's probably about the size of an SUV, if not bigger. And so you're talking about a telescope the size of a Chevy Suburban or a Ford Expedition. It might be even bigger than that. Probably like a U-Haul truck, if I remember correctly. It's about the same size as that. And so when you think about it, how do you get involved in this if you are Black, right? If you're supposed to be this Black American, how do you get involved in something like this without relying on bigger institutions such as NASA, such as the ESA, and so on and so forth? How do you create a pro-Black sort of space exploration program? You could do that with nano satellites or a CubeSat. So let me pull this up for those who you don't understand what I'm talking about. CubeSat. So we covered this a year or so ago. This is a CubeSat, okay? This is a open source satellite platform that you can build yourself. You can go down to Home Depot, you can get all the parts yourself, or you can order the parts online. So let's look at this real quick. This is a CubeSat design specification, revision 13. So this is the last build of this was 2014, okay? Let me go down to the introduction right here. Started in 1999, the CubeSat project began a collaborative effort between Professor Jody Poggiosori at California Polytechnic State University, San Luis Obispo, and Professor Bob Twiggs at Stanford University Space Systems Development Laboratory, SSDL. The purpose of the project is to provide a standard for design and PICO satellites to reduce costs and development time, increase accessibility to space and sustain frequent launches. Okay. Presently, the CubeSat project is an international collaboration of over 100 universities, high schools, and private firms developing PICO satellites containing scientific, private, and government payloads. A CubeSat is a 10 centimeter or cubic meter cube with a mass of up to 1.33 kilograms. Developers benefit from sharing of information within the community. If you are planning to start a CubeSat project, please contact Cal Poly, visit the CubeSat website at CubeSat.org. So these are the CubeSats on the table. These are the variations, okay? These are probably about the size of a Nintendo GameCube. All right? And so these are all the specifications in designing it. Okay? This is one of the examples here. So you can build these yourself. All the blueprints are right there on the website. All you gotta do is 3D print it out. You can feed it to a 3D printer and it'll print it out for you. And so let me go back real quick and show you some examples on Google, the image. This is a rendering of one of the coincidentally, it says a blockchain platform. And so the satellite is stackable. So that's what you see here is one or two or three satellites stacked on top of each other. Here you see, right, that's not a good picture. Here it is right here. You see right here is two of these satellites being used for cell phone communications. Okay, so you can build your own sort of Q-based satellite that would be actually used for broadband communication, okay? And it fits, you know, it's probably smaller than your keyboard. So you should be able to, if not, build something like this for research purposes, and they'll launch it for free, okay? You can piggyback a ride with the Russians or the Europeans or whoever else has a launch system, but then that's where we start talking about job creation, right? 3D printed rockets, 3D printed satellites, 3D printed components that go into all this type of stuff. You don't need to be a massive electrical engineer or computer engineer, although it'll help greatly. You don't really need to be that. As long as you could turn a wrench and solder, this is all that matters. Okay. Let me show you another one here. This is actually a pretty good one right here. It's a pretty good shot of a Q-based satellite. Has a 1.6 gigahertz quad core processor, 2 terabytes of storage on board, 80 watts an hour battery capacity, okay? And it shows this 47 megapixel camera on here. That's really good stuff. This is really good, 47 megapixels. And it has a wireless communication radio built into it at 1.8 gigabytes per second. That's DSL speeds, okay? That's broadband speeds. That's pretty good. The CubeSat went with one of the world's fastest satellite radios. Yeah, this is good. And these fins that you see on the outside of it right here are basically the solar panels to charge the battery. Okay, this is really good stuff. This is an example of what I was speaking about earlier. You can do this. You can see that comet with something like this. 47 megapixels is still a lot of high quality imaging. So you're talking DSLR sort of, DLSR or DSLR technology built into such a small canister. You're talking about a canister the size of a wine bottle. Okay. This is actually really good stuff. So this is the future of industrialization. You're talking about 3D printed rockets, 3D printed satellites. You don't need a big degree to even produce something like this. Okay. Here's another example of a Q-based satellite here. These competition right here, you know, people building Q-based satellites, you know, for profit. Here's another one here. Who knows what kind of lens and what kind of image quality this is going to produce. You don't send things like this up with cheap stuff on it. Cheap in terms of you're getting less quality per launch. You're doing this to put the best that you can behind it in such a small package and small form factor. So let me see what Canon Rebel. Let me see to their website and see what kind of lens are they using. I'll go to Nikon as well, just so I'm not biased. I don't own either one of these. What's the megapixel rating on these? 30x magnification on here. What's the specification? Okay, so they're talking 30 megapixels. Okay, fine. The other camera that we were looking at was 47 megapixels. That's pretty top notch. That's not, you know, that's no slouch. That's next generation quality. And so I'm bringing up this point because a camera like this would actually cost $2,500. You factor in that 47 megapixel camera that was in that Cubase satellite is probably around $5,000. So right off the top, you're spending $5,000 just on the telescoping camera to go into something like that. So your Cubase satellite is already $5,000 right out the gate. And then you're talking about another $2,000 to $3,000 just for the rest of the components, you know, the battery and the solar panels and the radio links, satellite radio links, and the structure itself, right? And it needs to be able to produce its own power. So there needs to be some kind of actuator inside of it that can actually keep turning power in it. I'm making this point so that people understand that you're talking about a satellite that would have cost $500 million 30 years ago is now costing $10,000 out the gate. And the blueprint is right on NASA's website and you can download it, okay? This is not far-fetched. This is real. This is a reality now. You have people who come through this channel and say, well, what are you talking about space exploration for? You know, that's not real. Space is not real. Why don't you open up a barbershop and you know, have a garage sale? You can make more money that way. This is poppycock. I say no. 3D printed rocket, 3D printed cube satellite. You can probably see all those comments streaking through the, through the solar system in real time with this satellite. If you can use a basic telescope now on the ground to see the moon, there's nothing saying that you cannot see comets streaking through the universe, or through the galaxy, I should say, our galaxy, with one of these Cubase satellites. You would open up the jobs, you would have manufacturing, you would have design, development, information technology, you know, production, supply chain logistics. I just named 10 jobs right off the rip. That's going to multiply. For every job that I just named, is going to have at least 10 to 20 other faculty and laborers under it. And so that's what goes on. And we have people coming here saying that this is not real. You can't talk about this. This is the future of jobs. These are the future of work. The days of going into Home Depot and lifting boxes and stuff like that, those days are over there, bro. They don't need people lifting boxes anymore. Strong Negroes, they don't need that. You cannot swag your way out of this. Either you upskill or you die. What's it gonna be? It doesn't get any easier than that. Danny George, what's going on? Either you upskill or you die. Space exploration, artificial intelligence, machine learning, we haven't even gotten into that part in terms of the satellite development. a satellite that has artificial intelligence that can render all this information in real time. Okay, machine learning, cloud computing, blockchain, 5G. Autonomous vehicle development, autonomous development itself. This is an industry in itself. Industrialization is happening right now. You have people saying that we don't need to talk about this. We don't need to talk about automation. Corona Bay. Get on Tinder. Go find yourself a little chippy. Okay, you do that. You have between 2020 and 2030 to get this right. If you don't figure it out, the community's finished. The community is finished. And you have people sitting in the manosphere talking about, you know, doxing people and all this other crazy stuff. This is happening right now. Everybody else is getting on board while there's a lot of shucking and jiving in the ministry about 2.0 versus 3.0 and Troy Ave in this one. Okay. You all do that. Over here, we're going to keep pushing these topics. We're going to keep talking about it week in and week out. Hope that somebody's hearing this. Y'all hit the like button. And